said, "Man, how do you listen to stuff? It's really scary." And I said, "You know, I know the end, right? I know how this all ends."
This is why in 2 Corinthians, Paul says that he's afraid for the Christians, because eventually there's going to come false teachers in the end times. They're going to be teaching a false gospel and a false Jesus.
That's one thing I don't understand. The book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that promises a blessing to those who read it. So why isn't it largely being studied? You know, it's the back of the book. It's the end of the story. It's Christ's victory. Why is this book so highly ignored?
Crisp spring day. All right.
Crisp. That's a good word. Like brisk?
Crisp. Crisp. We'll go ahead and get started. Real quick, by means of review, we are in the most important aspect of the seven letters, which is the personal application. So if you missed last week, shame on you. Just kidding. No. She was sick. I know. She was saving the rest of us. But by real quick means of review, you're lucky. I'm going to go over the bullets we went over real quick. But I thought it would be good to read the letter one more time. You can never read the letters, the seven letters, too many times. So we'll go ahead and read this one last time. Revelation 2, verses 18 through 29. It's good to read this because, once again, we're pulling from this letter now what we can all do as a body of believers, what we can do together in moving forward, what Jesus would have for us. "And to the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things says the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like fine brass. I know your works, love, service, faith, and your patience. And as for your works, the last are more than the first. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you, because you allow that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. And I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. Indeed, I will cast her into a sickbed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the hearts, the minds, and the hearts." That's one of the weirdest sentences in the whole book of Revelation, and we spent a long time on that. "And I will give to each one of you according to your works. Now to you I say, and to the rest in Thyatira, as many as do not have this doctrine, who do not have the Jezebel doctrine, who have not known the depths of Satan, as they say, I will put on you no other burden, but hold fast what you have till I come. And he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end." We're going to talk today about what does it mean to do the works of Jesus. This will be a good one. Does everybody think I say Jesus weird? They, these guys think I say Jesus. Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus.
It's different?
It is a little.
That's weird. I don't know what that, I don't know why I have, but we believe that it's evidence of the Holy Spirit in me because I emphasize.
Who did he die for? Who did he die for?
Us.
Jesus.
So it's all about us. No. See, this is the type of stuff we talk about on the weekends. They shall be dashed to pieces like the potter's vessels, as I have also received from my Father, and I will give the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So that is the longest of the seven letters. That's why we spent the most extensive time, and it's really crazy and deep and cryptic. I've already began, I'm pretty far into Sardis already, I promise you. The next letter is not going to be as long as this one, and it's not nearly as hard as this one was either. So maybe we'll get some class attendance back for the next letter. Okay, so Thyatira, personal application. So these are the ones we went over last week. If you missed it, you're going to have to watch it on YouTube, but we'll just read through them real quick. We must rest in the completed work of Jesus. Remember, the whole letter of Thyatira is talking about this consistent reworking and really trying to re-earn your salvation. Jesus says that we just need to rest in him. We must not lose sight of Jesus' deity. We must have love and doctrine. You can't have love without doctrine. And you can't have doctrine without love. We saw that from Ephesus. Our works will earn us rewards, not salvation. We must not allow false doctrine in our midst. So if you're ever in a church that teaches false doctrine, get out. But what we really looked at was that it has to be essential doctrine. You're never going to go to a church where you completely agree with every aspect of everything that everybody teaches and so on and so forth. But when it comes to essential doctrine, you must not allow false essential doctrine into your midst. You writing fast? We'll come back to it after class. Number six, it is important to know the Old Testament, and this letter specifically highlights that, especially with studying Jezebel and Mystery Babylon and the Tower of Babel. You have to know all of that stuff to really grasp what Jesus was saying in this letter. And as we've stated, we're going to be going to the Old Testament a lot because there's 800 allusions to the Old Testament in the book of Revelation itself. That's why a lot of people have a hard time understanding Revelation, because they don't know their full Bible. Number seven, it's important to understand what happened before and after the Tower of Babel, and the creation of the Mystery Babylonian religious system. And once again, I spent a lot of time with you guys on this because there's three chapters in Revelation that are dedicated to Mystery Babylon, Revelation 17, 18, and 19. Without this background of Jezebel and Mystery Babylon, we won't be able to grasp what's going on. And when I teach you guys Revelation 17, 18, and 19 and some of the different views that are held as to what exactly Mystery Babylon is, you're going to start to connect even more of the dots in your head, and I think it's going to blow your guys' mind. Number eight, be prepared with a defense to the false seed deception. We spent a lot of time talking about this false trinity that's been presented all the way back into the ancient religions. Number nine, any mystical theological revelation must be viewed through the lens of our 66 books. So we're not against mystical revelation, but if it says anything contrary to what we already have revealed in the Bible, we have to throw it out. Number 10, we must guard our hearts and our minds. It was important for us in this letter to see that Jezebel taught and seduced. So teaching is through the mind. Seduction is through the... is that your phone?
Oops.
Wow. I just had a relapse to a video. See, that was a famous video game when we were kids. I literally pictured him doing the whole thing. All right. So when you teach, the teaching goes through your mind. Seduction is through your heart. So she was seducing the minds and the hearts. Therefore, it's important for us as believers to really guard both our minds and our emotional experiences. We must not give worship to anything other than the one true God who has revealed himself as Trinitarian. We must recognize various forms of works-based religion and explain how Jesus is different. This whole church period that we studied from 600 to 1500 was really a works-based religion. What's amazing is we believe in a gospel, and we believe that only the gospel of Jesus tells us, says that we as human beings, we can't earn salvation ourselves. Unfortunately, that's the hardest part for man to grasp, because it requires ultimate what? Repentance and humility to come before God and say, I can't do it myself, God. I can't do anything. I need you. That's the beginning step of the gospel, is saying I can't. So, with that being said, that's our old stuff. Let's get into some new, and T-Hood will lead us in a word of prayer here.
Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day. We thank you so much for the ability to look at your word and glean from it what you would have us glean. Father, we just ask that you would open up our hearts and lives to the most important section of the letters, and that's the personal application part. So we love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You
want to check it? All right. Still good. Okay. So number 13, lucky number 13, we must understand the purpose of spiritual rituals. So we saw during this church period a lot of rituals come to play. A lot of saying prayers in the right way, saying prayers over and over again, doing certain things at certain places. We saw a lot of rituals. Do you guys know what I mean by rituals? Doing kind of the same things over and over again? So what truly is the purpose of a ritual? Is it that we're just doing things for the sake of doing them? Obviously the answer is no, but what the true purpose of spiritual rituals is it will lead us to what we call spiritual disciplines. Okay. This is going to be super important for us. So what are spiritual disciplines? I'm giving you guys a list of essential spiritual disciplines. So how do we grow more like Christ? How do we grow in deeper fellowship with the Father, with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit? These lists are essential. What are you giggling at? What did I do? These lists are essential for us to grow. Do you want to grow closer to God? Okay, these are some of the things, according to God's word, that we have to do. So, let's see what these are. One, prayer. We can't grow closer to God if we're not praying. We can't grow closer to God if we're not asking Him for things, if we're doing certain things, if we're depending on Him, so on and so forth. That's kind of an easy one. Number two, reading the Bible. Straight, simply reading the Bible, gathering your daily bread. You just sit there, you read it, read a few chapters a day, let God speak to you through a few verses or however He speaks to you, but read the Bible. You can't be a Christian and growing in your walk with Jesus if you're not reading the Bible. Number three, fasting. And yes, Brooks, that says fasting. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about fasting here for a second. Matthew 6, right after Jesus tells us how to pray, right after He teaches us how to pray, He gives us the model prayer. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. He gives us the model prayer. Then He goes on and He explains something else. He says, moreover, when you fast, do not be like the hypocrites. He didn't say, if you want to fast, or if you choose to fast. He says, when you fast. Do not be like the hypocrites with a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear to men to be fasting. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face. So what Jesus is teaching here is back in the day, it was very common for the religious Jews of the time to fast and to even fake fast to make it appear as though they were fasting so that the world would say, hey, look, that's a super religious dude. Okay, look at him. He's fasting, he's hungry, he's so on and so forth. But Jesus here is saying when you do fast, it's not about the public knowing you're fasting. It's about you and your relationship to God. It's about you internally growing and seeking more with Christ. So when you fast, don't let anybody know you're fasting. Now, I'm not saying if we do a corporate fast and we're all talking about, hey, I'm doing this Daniel fast, that's cool. But if you're going around and saying, yeah, I'm fasting, look at me. You know, you've got the wrong mindset to what a true biblical fast is. A fast is letting go of the things of this world. One of the things we're always talking about is being heavenly minded, right? Jesus says, be heavenly minded, lay for yourself treasure in heaven. One of the ways you do that is you detach from the things of this world. One of the things that a lot of people detach from is food. I don't know about you guys, but I can easily attach to any food over and over again, especially pizza, especially donuts. So when I let go of some of these things, and when I'm hungry, when I'm craving them, and I take that second to be like, why can I not eat pizza? Oh, that's right, because God, I want more of You, right? And it gives you a little bit more time to kind of focus on God. Now, anyone who says, I don't want to fast food, Brooks, you don't have to only fast food, right? There's multiple things that you can let go of, especially in this world we live in today. Obviously, the Pharisees back then didn't have Facebook, right? They might have had something similar, but they didn't have Facebook. So we can...
The temple gate.
Temple what?
Hanging out the gate of the city, the gate mm-hmm. of the village. That was their Facebook.
Yeah. Hey, what's going on today? Yeah, they would just all list the drama, right? Lay out the drama. What's up?
You can fast other things.
Yep. Amen.
Or sacrifice other things, but a true fast is food.
Yes.
It takes King's stomach off the throne. When you're thinking about your belly hurting, it's to focus on God.
Amen.
And it doesn't take very many minutes for it to start rumbling.
Yep, it's true. Yeah, food is the number one way. Gotta let go of all these burgers. But that is an essential spiritual discipline. Jesus multiple times said that a follower of Him is going to pray and fast. Sometimes when you really need to get a hold of God, and don't get me wrong, is He always there? Of course. But when you kind of come more into focus with Him, if you have bigger issues going on in your life, if you have bigger decisions to be made in life, spend a day where you fast that day and in prayer seek Him I promise you, he'll reveal things to you that you wouldn't, or you'll see things that you wouldn't see had you not been fasting. So, that is an essential spiritual discipline. Number four, studying the Bible. Notice that number two and number four are different, right? There's a difference between just daily reading the Bible, daily eating your manna, and number four, studying the Bible. The reason I love all of you guys is because this is what we're doing. Okay, we're studying the Bible. We're going verse by verse. We're really going back to the ancient Greek, the ancient Hebrew. That's important. You know, that's an important part of discipline. Because once again, a lot of the things we study in this class is what you would call doctrine or teachings. And Paul over and over again says, guard yourself against wrong doctrine, learn true doctrine, understand doctrine. How can you not understand true doctrine as a Christian? That drives me crazy. You, as you learn more about who God is, you worship more fully, just like we talked about last week. When I'm reading these songs up there, and when I'm saying Jesus paid it all, and my nerd brain goes theologically to some of the things I've learned in the scriptures, I'm able to worship even greater because I have a greater grasp of who God is. And that's, once again, kind of that mind-heart connection. And that's why it's important for us to always continue to study the Bible. Okay, number five is probably my favorite. Tita, will you grab, I was going to show them something. Grab my, there's a book in there that I was going to show you. I want you guys to write this down because this book has literally transformed my spiritual world. My grandma sent this to me in the mail and I thought she was the craziest woman ever. But she sent me this when I was baby Christian. And it is, I've literally for I started following Jesus in 2008. 8 years I've been reading this book and going over and over and over again. It's called, you can see it up there on the board, but it's called Face to Face, Praying the Scriptures for Intimate Worship. I'm going to teach you guys one of my spiritual disciplines, and hopefully it'll edify some of you guys. But this is, I'm the kind of guy who I need structure, I need something to kind of follow. But you can find this on Amazon Prime for a penny, and then you just have to pay for shipping. If anybody wants a copy of this, let me know, I'll buy it. It's that good. Deal. Yep, I'll just start ordering them all on Amazon. So let's go over a few pages. I'm sorry about the lighting here. So what this book does is it kind of takes you through different aspects of prayer. And it's actually modeled off of the Lord's Prayer, but each aspect of how we pray towards God. So for instance, right there at the top, you see adoration. When you go into prayer, it's important to not always just go straight to asking God for things, right? We're like a little baby kid. God, I need this. God, I need that. God, I need this. God, I need that. It's like he's our little pinball machine, you know, or our, what is it? I don't know. Not pinball machine, but it's just like we can just ask him for whatever we want.
Genie
in a bottle. Yes, that's what I was going for. See, I always mix my metaphors really bad. But wouldn't it be smarter for us to kind of get our minds right as to who God is before? Imagine you're sitting down at the table with God. Or are you just going to start saying, hey, God, give me this, right? Instead, we're going to get to kind of worship him. We're going to kind of get to say, hey, this is what I think about you. That's what adoration is. So what this book does is it literally takes scripture and you pray the scriptures back to God. So you pray, as the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for you, the living God. When shall I come and appear before you? So what I do is while I'm reading that, I kind of tell him some of my personal stuff, how I'm feeling towards him. Notice there at the bottom, after you get to, so at the bottom of adoration, pause to express your thoughts of praise and worship. So then you take, after you pray through the scriptures, you take kind of your personal moment and you say whatever you want to say to God at that time. Okay? So you're just telling him how much you feel and care for him. Number two, if we're going, and we're going to continue to build through this, what's up?
You check that.
Yeah. We're still good. I think as long as I don't move it, it's
well,
good.
It kind of.
Oh, flicker?
Yeah.
Okay, next, number two, you confess, right? You confess your downfalls. You confess what's going on in your life. I basically confess every day, God, I need your grace. You know, I need you. I know I mess up every day. But anyways, you read through that prayer, and then ask the Spirit to search your heart and reveal any areas of unconfessed sin. So God will lay on your heart, are there areas that you need to have cleansed? Are there any areas that you need to be cleansed of before you move closer into God? Then number three, renewal. So now we're asking for God to make us more like him, like his son. So I'll give you an example here. With regard to my former way of life, may I put off my old self. So right there I would pause and say, God, make me make me more fully put off my old self, the old fleshly chunk, and let me be more the new, right? Which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, and be renewed in the spirit of my mind. God, help me renew my mind. God, help me to guard my mind. Help me to learn as I'm guard my mind as I'm learning new things. May I put on the new self. God, help me to know what it means to put on the new self. Help me learn what it means to walk by your spirit. And you're literally just praying this out. You're praying those scriptures back to God. You guys see how this could be extremely beneficial?
If God's word is powerful, so when you're spitting his word back to him, imagine the response, you know what I mean? It's
exactly.
It's pretty incredible.
So you kind of go through the scripture verses there, then you pause to add, so any other personal renewal things that are on your heart, you say to him. The next is your petition. So now when you're petitioning God, this is when you're actually saying, okay, God, here's what I need from you, right? Here's what I need from you, my loving Heavenly Father. And once again, there's a little verse there you can pray through. I highlighted that one, and I just randomly picked these. They don't have significance necessarily. But I like this one. Brooks, you'll like this one too. May I discipline myself to godliness, for physical exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things. So what Paul's saying here is, guys, it's good to take care of your body. It's good to work out. It's cool for down here in the physical. But practicing godliness, studying the word, praying the word, that's even more important. Right? Because it's going to last us in the life to come. Mm-hmm. So right there, you pray through that, and then you pause here, petition God to help you to be a faithful steward of your time. That's one of my favorite prayers. And by the way, so each day, this has like 3 months, and each day it's something different. It guides you through something different. God, who doesn't need to be a more faithful steward of their time? Right? Who doesn't need to be a more faithful steward of your talents? So what has God given you? God, help me to be a better steward of what you've given me. Possessions and relationships. God, help me to be a better steward of the possessions, the things in my life. God, how can I serve you better with my house, with my job, with my car? How can I be a servant to others with what you've given me? Relationships. This is where I pray about my circle of influence. You guys always hear me talk about my circle of influence. God, you've given me certain relationships in my life, my wife, my friends, my coworkers. How can I serve you in that? How can I be a better steward of what you've given me in the circle of relationships? Offer prayers of petition regarding your activities for this day. So at this time, you can kind of pray. You can walk God through what's going on in your life that day. I usually do this book a lot at night. So when it gets to that point, I actually just thank him for certain things that happen throughout the day, or I'll re-go over some of the things. But if you do it in the morning, you can say, God, I've got this going on today. I need help. God, I've got this going on today. I need help. Petition him there. Next is intercession. May I give to all what they are due. Okay, read that scripture verse. And then at this point, this guy, Kenneth Boa, he gives you certain ideas as to what you can intercede for. He's got all different things you can pray for. At this point is when I take my personal list, my personal intercession list, and I have different categories of intercession. By the way, if you guys don't have a list yet, you should have a list of who specifically you want to pray for, on what days, and so on and so forth. But just kind of organize that however you feel. But it's at this time that I will do an intercession. I'll plug in my own stuff here. Or if you don't have anything to plug in, you can follow what's on the book. He says, intercede on behalf of your local, state, or provincial, or national governments. We're commanded in Scripture to pray for government, right? It's scary. I'm supposed to pray for everyone in the government, okay? So that's one of my hardest prayers that I go through, but I do it.
I think it's neat that when I take my prayer list and like somebody that I maybe haven't prayed for in a while, like if someone asks you something, you know, we always say to people like, hey, let me pray for you. Can I pray for you? And like a lot of, or like even in passing in a conversation, be like, okay, well, I'll pray for you. You know, you can do it on the spot, of course. And that's probably the best thing to do. And then when you tell somebody you're praying for them, if you add that to your list, so maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks later, you're looking at your list and, you're, and you say, oh, this person had, their mother had cancer. Mm-hmm. And then you get back in touch with that person and say, hey, you know, how's your mother doing? I've been praying for it. You know, like imagine the impact that would have, especially on an unbeliever, you know, like if they have a situation and they don't believe in prayer and God responds to that prayer, and then you can follow up through it. You know what I mean? Like, it's pretty powerful.
Yeah.
Testimony.
Yeah, what's amazing too is when you do these lists and stuff, especially when we do it at the shop, you know, we'll pray for somebody and then they'll eventually come back and
you'd be amazed at how many times you see the answered prayer. Maybe they don't reach back and tell you, but God works these prayers. You know, He answers these prayers, and it's edifying you as a believer to know that you get to work with God on this stuff. So that's another reason why prayer lists are important. So there's your time in intercession. So affirmation, this is where you're affirming the Scripture. So you read the Scripture, and then you say in your heart, God, I know this is true. So let's take their example here. Those who pursue righteousness and love find life, righteousness, and honor. So those who pursue righteousness and love, God, I know if I pursue righteousness and love, I will find true life. And you just affirm the Scriptures. Last page here. So you would pause to reflect on those biblical affirmations that you read through. Then finally, thanksgiving. This one's fun. You just get to thank God, and He gives you different Scripture verses to thank Him through. For instance, we'll go through an example here. You are the Lord our God who brought your people out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery.
God, thank you for bringing me out of Egypt. God, thank you for delivering me from the old Chuck. Thank you for saving me out of Egypt and bringing me into the promised land. And then finally, your closing prayer where you just read the Scripture back to Him. You are the Lord who created the heavens. You are God. You fashioned and made the earth and established it. You did not create it to be empty, but formed it to be inhabited. You are the Lord, and there is no other. And you're just praying that back to God. So, like I said, highly recommend the prayer book, and I will get multiple copies of this for a penny. And you can just maybe pay me $5, maybe I'll give it to you for free. We'll see what happens. We'll see if I feel like tithing, no, my extra offering on top of my tithe that day. Okay. It's all good. I want to earn eternal rewards. I want to put some money up in my heavenly checking account. Okay, so those were the spiritual disciplines. And once again, I want you guys to remember that list, we don't just go through prayers. You'll notice that at the church in that time, they just kind of said the same babbling prayers over and over. And I don't mean to pick on certain things, but there are certain prayers within the Roman Catholic Church today where they say the same prayer 7 times in a row, then they say a prayer, then they say the same prayer 7 times in a row. That's not what spiritual disciplines are about, right? It's not about just doing a work. And once again, that's what it comes down to. They've made spiritual disciplines a work, right? They've made it, you just check it off the list. Okay, I read Scripture today, check. Okay, I prayed today, check. That's not what spiritual disciplines are about. Spiritual disciplines are about taking the focus off of you and putting it on God. So that's why we do those. Okay, number 14, we don't need a special priest class for forgiveness or knowledge. This was made apparent in this letter. We'll come back and we'll talk about this in a little bit with some Scripture. We don't need a special priest class. We don't have to go through a priest class for forgiveness. We get to go directly to God. And we don't need a special higher church class for knowledge. We get to go straight to God. And number 15, our sin was atoned for once and for all through the completed work of the cross. And once again, I'll come back to this in a little bit when we look at some Scriptures that talk about some of the theology that was prevalent during this time in church history. Okay, this will be the one I conclude with today as we run getting close to time here. But we must understand the doctrine of imminence. And it's important. We've talked about this before, but let's just reiterate that it's really important. The doctrine of imminence is the doctrine that Jesus can come back. And yes, I said Jesus can come back at any time. He could come back before I finish this class. He could come back before I finish the sentence. Wouldn't that be amazing if we were all just immediately ushered into the presence of Jesus? Let's talk about this. So here's the important question. According to your eschatology, everyone sitting in this room, according to your eschatology, and just so you know, every Christian has an eschatology, whether they know it or not. What is your beliefs about the end times? Okay, eschatology, the study of the end times. What is your belief on that? And the question that you have to ask yourself is, can Jesus come back today, according to your eschatology? I know that sounds kind of like a crazy question, but I want you guys to know that a majority of Christians, according to their eschatology, Jesus can't come back today. He can't even appear today. Okay, and I'll show you why. But this is the important question. And just so you know, our view, where we believe that Jesus can come back at any time, is under heavy attack today. Just so you know, it's under massive, heavy attack. So Jesus is obviously closer than you think. Okay, he is in the rearview mirror here. So I found it fascinating this week that there was a study that came out among Protestant pastors. So Lifeway Research came out with a poll, thousands of pastors. Notice that up there, this is Protestant pastors. This isn't Roman Catholic, this is Protestants, okay? Just so you know, once again, we're considered Protestants, okay? Which of the following statements best describes your views on when the biblical rapture will occur? Thankfully, the highest percentage was pre-tribulational beliefs. We're good. But amazingly, only 36% believe in what we would call a pre-tribulational rapture. Okay, meaning that only 36%, and by the way, these are pastors, guys. This isn't like, you know, your common laity sitting in the church pews. These are the people who are leading the flocks, okay? They don't believe in a pre-tribulational rapture. What's even more scary is look at the stat underneath that. One out of four pastors doesn't believe that the rapture should be taken literally, that there is no literal rapture where Jesus is going to take the believers in the twinkling of an eye as described in 1 Corinthians 15 and 1 Thessalonians 4. It's just a metaphor. Okay, that's the kind of the growing belief. 18% believe in what's post-tribulational, and this view is really gaining ground, that everybody takes Matthew 24 where Jesus says, after the tribulation of those days, then you will see the Son of Man coming. So they say, okay, well, it's after the tribulation. That's when Jesus comes. So we all just got to sit tight down here and prepare for Armageddon. Mid-tribulational view, 4%. Pre-wrath view, 4%. Pre-wrath is slightly growing. Preterism, unfortunately, to some people who call themselves the Bible answer man, this view doesn't seem to be growing. But preterism is 1%, and 8% say, I don't even know what that means. Okay. So I find this fascinating. And when you think about this, here's what I'm trying to tell you guys. One out of every three pastors, okay, basically only one out of every three believes that Jesus can come back today. Just so you know, as I've stated, only the pre-tribulational view, remember, we have a tribulation coming, Daniel's 70th week. It's that 7-year period that we all talk about. We believe there's going to be a rapture before this Daniel 70th week that's coming, okay? So only the pre-tribulational view that's in view here, only that view allows Jesus to come back today, okay? Period, end of story. So only one out of every three pastors in American churches believes that Jesus can come back today. That's mind-blowing, okay? That's shows you that there's some big changes that are going on in studying eschatology. Because once again, I want you guys to get, if you believe in a post-tribulational view, mid-trib, pre-wrath, I'm not even going to talk about preterism, but if you believe any of those views, okay, the Antichrist has to be revealed, there has to be a 7-year peace treaty signed with Israel, enforced with Israel, and then all this stuff has to happen before Jesus can come back. And that destroys what's called the doctrine of imminency. Do you guys see how that works? So once again, we have to be really careful when we study eschatology. Do you have something to add to that?
I just, you know, it's just one of those things where I heard a pastor, kind of talk about it like this. Imagine you're at work and your boss is going to go to lunch and your boss leaves and it seems like they're taking a while to get back and you don't know what time they're going to get back. But when your boss gets back, wouldn't you want everything at the office or everything where you work to be like in order, you know? And wouldn't it, like, if your boss was going to call and check in like 2 minutes before he got there, wouldn't you wait for that check-in to really get things in order? Basically what I'm saying is when you don't know what time your boss is coming back, you have to make sure things in order the whole time because he could come back at any minute, you know? And that's the doctrine of imminence. Yep. Jesus come back in any minute. Your house better be in order, right?
Yep.
I've also heard, taught that like your kids, like you leave your teenager at home to watch the little kids or something, like, and they don't know what time you'll be back. You don't tell them when you're coming back. You just say, okay, we'll be back.
I remember those days when my parents would leave, so I couldn't have a house party.
You don't know if they're coming back. They could be gone a day. They could be gone 2 days, but you don't know. You know, they might call and check in. Yeah, we're on our way back.
Yeah.
But it's that anxiety, that nervousness that keeps you in order, right?
Yep.
You know, that's the doctrine of imminence. And all those other views, they're looking for other things besides Jesus.
Right. So that's why you'll always hear me and Tyler say, are you looking for Jesus or are you looking for the Antichrist? All these other views, these post-tribulationists, these mid-guys, these pre-wrath guys, they're all trying to figure out who the Antichrist is. I honestly don't care who the Antichrist is. I know that's a crazy thought, but I know that Jesus says, do your job until you're taken out of here. I could die tomorrow. I don't have time to worry about, is this guy or this guy the Antichrist? That's not on my radar, okay? Do you have something?
No. I think I know who it is.
Good. Are you being serious?
Yeah.
Is this a joke?
It's Hillary Clinton.
Oh.
That's my guess so far.
No, I don't.
The man of sin.
Okay. Okay. But anyways, isn't it fascinating? Once again, so one out of three pastors are looking for the return of Jesus. Okay. Two out of three pastors, according to their eschatology, whether they know it or not, Jesus can't come back. It's Chuck Mizer always tells a joke. One of his college professors who makes fun of all the other views other than pre-tribulational, he would sing a song in class. He would say, sad day, Jesus can't come back today. Because according to any other view, Jesus can't come back. And that, isn't it amazing in Scripture that those two out of three pastors, they have to basically throw out the views where Jesus says to look for his coming and to be prepared for his coming because he comes like a thief in the night. Once again, any other eschatological view other than pre-tribulationalism, you basically have to allegorize what Jesus is saying right here through Paul. Okay, Paul, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So the appearing of Jesus is a blessed hope. It's something that we look for and hope, that we're excited about. We're excited and we're hoping that Jesus comes and gets us. Now, I really broke down the Greek words looking for, and guess what they say? Looking for. We are to be looking for Jesus, literally, to come back and get us, okay? Where it's not an allegory, it's not a metaphor, but we are to be looking for his return. Notice there that it says in our glorious appearing, looking for the blessed hope and our glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. Remember that word. 2 Timothy 4:8, finally there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness. This is one of the five crowns, okay, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And by the way, that day is the Bema Seat judgment, the day of Christ, where he hands out rewards. Guess what he says? The crown of righteousness is given to him, but not only him, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Okay? So there is a certain group of believers that are going to be excited and love the thought of Jesus coming back. Does that sound like some of us in this room? I don't know about you guys, but I want this special crown that looks forward to Jesus' coming back. And once again, that should highlight to you that it's probably possible, not probably, but probable, that a lot of Christians are not going to receive a reward for looking for Jesus' return. Do you see that? I want this special crown, and I want Jesus to come today and give it to me. Okay? But notice that word there. Remember, in Titus 2, we are to be looking for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing, the same appearing that's listed here, but also to all who have loved his appearing. So, that is why it's important for us to understand the doctrine of imminence. The reason why I bring this out in the letter of Thyatira, because remember, he said to the remnant in Thyatira, those who don't hold to the doctrines of Jezebel, he says, just hold on, sit tight until I come. He's saying, just wait until I come and get you. That's the doctrine of imminence. He can come at any time. We must do the works of Jesus. We're going to start there next week. So anybody, do you guys want to do the works of Jesus? I do. I've got a really good list for you guys of how to do the works of Jesus. It's going to be a mind-blowing class, and you're going to be super edified. But let's pray and get out of here. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Once again, we thank you for the spiritual disciplines that you've given us. We thank you for all the different ways that we can turn our focus on you and to give our hearts and our minds to you. Thank you for your holy word, and thank you that we get to pray your word back to you, God. We thank you for the promise that you are soon going to tell your son to go get his bride. You are soon going to tell him to come and save us. And But until then, God, we'll continue to work and we'll continue to tell people about your grace and tell people that they need to get saved, that they need to make it right. We will continue to be ambassadors of reconciliation to this world, and we will occupy until you come. Please come quickly, Lord Jesus. Prepare our hearts and our minds for you today with whatever else you have for us. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you've enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.